All right, so what I want to commence my lecture with today is a discussion which continues from where I left off. I was describing for you very briefly the economic situation in India in the 1830s, 1840s, in the years preceding the rebellion of 1857. I'm just going to spend a few minutes on that and then move on to what the rebellion was about, what were the circumstances that led to it, and what have been, according to historians who have looked into that period, including myself, some of the major reasons for this rebellion of 1857, and from there then move on to the emergence of Indian nationalism. So in the 1830s, I mean, in my concluding remarks, what I'd mentioned to you was that if you look at the period from the early 1800s to the 1830s, 1840s, what you find, and there are many sources for this, the source that I'd recommended as one of the most well-known works, obviously, of its kind anywhere is Marx's Capital, particularly Volume 1. It's a huge work in several volumes, but Capital 1, in fact, actually has a fairly detailed, extensive analysis of how India, which used to be a principal exporter of textiles, ended up becoming a major importer, in fact, the largest importer of textiles in the world. Now, one of the most sordid chapters in the history of British India is the opium trade. Okay, and this is something that many historians didn't really write about very much. In recent years, more attention has been paid to it, including attention paid to it by a number of writers of fiction who have offered interesting interpretations of what happened in the 1820s, 30s, 40s. And when I speak of the Opium Wars, I'm speaking of two wars, the first Opium War, 1839 to 1842, and the second Opium War, 1856 to 1860. It is important to acknowledge, and all we can really do here is simply acknowledge that because we don't have the time to look into it in great detail, the fact that the city of Bombay, the great metropolis of Bombay, was built on the back of the opium trade. Okay, and in fact, the people who were major players in that trade, whom I have not mentioned to you in this class up till this point in time, although they constitute a distinct minority in India with an extraordinary history of their own, are the Zoroastrians, or the Parsis, as they're known in India, right? So the Parsis came to India 1,000 years ago from Iran, right? And as I said, the community has a long settled history. Many of the industrial houses that we think about, including the Tatas, the famous industrial house of Tatas, this is a Parsi family, okay? Right? So the Parsis were very active as middlemen in this trade. And what was this trade all about? To understand that, what we have to do is we have to go back to the early 1700s, and we have to consider the fact that there was a very high demand in Europe for Chinese goods such as tea, silk, and porcelain, right? Now, what China got in return was silver, although you have to keep in mind that Britain was itself on the gold standard, not on the silver standard. Britain was on the gold standard, so what Britain had to do first was to purchase silver, and then they would send the silver to China in return for tea, silk, and porcelain. Now, when India becomes a British colony, one of the things that they realize is that you can actually grow opium, right? And instead of sending the silver, you send opium. So it's a triangular trade. And much of this trade between Britain and China is being intermediated by the opium that is being grown in India. In 1729, the Chinese emperor issued a ban, okay, on the sale and use of opium for the obvious reason that he realized, the Chinese emperor at that time, that this was an addictive substance. Okay? Now, the East India Company, nonetheless, is going to... And it's mainly private merchants at this point in time. You know, throughout the second half of the 1700s, the early 1800s, there are a lot of British merchants who would, in fact, actually, you know, smuggle the opium into China from India. And just to give you a sense of what kind of volume we're speaking about, in 1730, the British export of opium was 15 tons to China. In 1773, 75 tons. In the 1820s, 900 tons. And in 1838, the year before the First Opium War, 1,400 tons. So just remember, from 1730 to 1838, you go from 15 tons to 1,400 tons. And the historians have looked at this and have estimated that there must have been something close to 50 to 80 million addicts of opium in China by the 1830s. So China imposed a trade embargo on opium in 1839, a complete embargo, right, with confiscation of private goods of opium coming into the country and so on. And this is what led to the Opium War of 1839, right? And here again, these are complicated histories that we can't look into, but the British Indian armies themselves would actually go into Canton, right? So you remember that the East India Company has an army, right? Because now we have moved a long ways from 1757 from Plassey, because recall that by the early 1800s, British expansion in India is taking place rapidly. And I had sketched out for you very briefly the Anglo-Burmese Wars, the Anglo-Sikh Wars, the decimation of the Marathas, and so on. So by the early 1800s, what you have to imagine is that Britain is in control of large parts of India. All right? So this is what is referred to as the Opium Wars. Now, there's something else that is going on that is extraordinarily interesting. And again, I'm simply going to mention it because it's a chapter unto itself. In fact, I teach an entire course on the question of Indian migration overseas. But beginning in the 1830s, there is going to be substantial Indian indentured migration. Indentured here means these are people, largely peasants, the vast majority of them coming from the hinterland, from the interior. And very often they don't even know where they're going, by the way. Okay? So these are people coming from the hinterland, from the Indian countryside. They go to the coastal regions where they will board a ship which will take them to places such as Guyana, Trinidad, Suriname, Jamaica, Mauritius, and then beginning in the 1870s, 1880s, Fiji, South Africa, Malaysia. You know, I mean, for those of you who are interested, you would know that in the Caribbean. I mean, there are countries such as Trinidad, you know, which have a majority Indian population, okay? Fiji, the majority of the population in Fiji used to be Indian until outward migration in the last 2-3 decades. How did that happen? These are Indian indentured laborers. They are going there to work on sugar plantations. Okay? Although they don't know, the vast majority of them, that they're actually going to be put on a boat which is going to take them. They're just looking for economic prospects. And of course, the outward migration of these Indians beginning in the 1830s, this is going to come to a stop in 1917 when Indian nationalist opinion is going to demand that Indian indentured labor stop. Because these people, when they go to Mauritius, Fiji, Guyana, Suriname, and so on, they're going to be exploited, of course. Right? And the vast majority of them, as I said, are peasants, they're illiterate, right? And they have no protection. In fact, what they are effectively doing is they are taking the place of the slaves, right? Because slavery had been abolished by the 1830s in British possessions around the world. That's in effect what is really going on. And the indentured laborers are people who are going and they're signing a contract for 5 years to work at these places. Okay? But what it indicates to you, and we're not speaking about a handful or a trickle of people, all right? We're speaking about several million people who are going to leave India's shores, okay, as indentured laborers, beginning in the 1830s, when they first go to Mauritius, that's the first place they go to, then they're going to go to Trinidad, to the British Caribbean, right? Okay, and henceforth through other places. What this migration indicates is the dire economic prospects they have in India itself. Okay? And throughout the 1880s, 1890s, if I can just finish with this chapter of the economic history, or just little nuggets of it, India is going to be racked by famines. Right? So if you're down in the Madras Presidency, for example, in the south of India, you're going to have famines in the 1880s, 1890s, and each of these famines is going to lead to several million deaths every time you have a famine of this kind. All right? So what we are saying is that the economic situation of India is going to certainly deteriorate very substantially under British rule. All right? Now, in the 1850s, in 1857 to be precise, in May of 1857, you're going to have a huge rebellion. Yeah, the traditional term for it is the Sepoy Mutiny. Okay, the Sepoys are the foot soldiers.
Okay.
But the word mutiny is no longer the preferred word, because a mutiny suggests that the British Army of India was illegitimate army. Okay? I mean, you have when soldiers mutiny, they're mutinying against legitimate rule. The question here is, was the British rule of India legitimate to begin with? Right? So the preferred term today is the Indian Rebellion of 1857-1858, but some of the traditional works that you see in the older works that would refer to the Sepoy Mutiny of 1857. Now, there are a huge number of reasons, okay, that cause the rebellion. It breaks out essentially in North India in a place called Meerut, which is not too far from Delhi. Again, a couple of hundred kilometers. So this is Delhi over here, right? And here you have, you know, Lucknow. Okay, and remember that Calcutta is here, Bombay is here, just so that you remember your geography, Madras is over here. Okay, or Chennai as it's called today, right? So Meerut is over here, pretty close to Delhi. So there's going to be a rebellion that's going to break out in early May 1857, the 100th anniversary of Plassey. So some people have thought that, well, it's not a mere coincidence that, you know, that there was a kind of a millenarian vision that was in part responsible for the rebellion of 1857. Okay? And the older histories would tell you that there was a very simple reason why the rebellion took place. I mean, now we know, in fact, that this was simply the match that, you know, lit the fire that was going to take place anyhow. And the simple reason that is given is that there were these new rifles that had been issued to the sepoys. Who are the sepoys? The foot soldiers, and they're largely Muslims and Hindus. Okay? So they have this new Enfield rifle that had been issued to the soldiers. Now, when you put a cartridge in it, you had to bite off the end of the cartridge. The cartridge was greased with either beef fat, okay, or pork fat. Now, if it's pork fat, it's obviously offensive to the Muslims. If it's beef fat, it's offensive to the Hindus. And so the argument is that the religious sensibilities of the Indians were so offended that they decided that they could not tolerate this insult to their religion, and this is why the rebellion broke out. But as I said, this is obviously the catalyst. There are much more profound reasons for why you have a rebellion in 1857. And I'm going to just enumerate them in serial order very quickly and try to discuss some of them. Right? Number one, I think the question of racial pride is important. By the 1820s, it is very clear. And I think that this coincides in part. So here is a second reason. I'm combining two now. By the 1820s, something is happening, and this is going to coincide with the emergence of Christian missionary activity. Remember that missionaries had not been permitted to proselytize in India in the second half of the 1700s, in the very early 1800s. When the charter of the East India Company is renewed in 1813, this prohibition on Christian missionary activity is going to be lifted. And recall what Bentinck is, the evangelical governor general of 1829, right? Who's going to be the person under whose jurisdiction the ban on sati is going to take place. Okay? So we're saying two things here. Number one, there is this kind of racial pride that the British have, where they think that they are better than the Brahmins, if I may put it this way. You know, far from, in a sense, rebelling against the Indian caste system, I want to suggest to you that the British out-Brahmined the Brahmins. And this, of course, is highly offensive. They, in a sense, work with the system and place themselves at the top of the hierarchy. It is not unusual to find letters written by Englishmen back home talking about the niggers. This is the word that is used to describe the Indians back home in the 1820s. Okay? 1820s, 1830s. So growing racial sentiments, number one. Number two, growing Christian missionary activity. And a consequence of that is that obviously the religious sentiments of the Indians are being offended. Number three, the inability of Indians to take part in their own administration. And this was really not the case with previous imperial systems in India. I mean, in fact, we saw that under the Mughals, there was a growing degree of indigenization, an attempt to incorporate the Indians. What the British do, in fact, is they shut out the Indians, especially from higher administrative positions of all kinds. Right? Number four, the policies followed by Lord Dalhousie, who is the Governor General of India in the 1840s. And in particular, two policies. One is the policy of what is called paramountcy. Okay, so the word, you've heard the word paramount, of course. Paramount means supreme. So the doctrine of paramountcy, okay, which simply stipulated the following. That when the British thought that a native kingdom was not being administered properly, and you have to keep in mind what I've said to you on a number of occasions, that the British have a system of direct and indirect rule. There are various provinces, various kingdoms that they're not ruling directly. Right? So if you're looking at the history of British India, we are saying that by the 1850s, 1860s, two-thirds of the country will be officially what is called British India, and then there are going to be all of these native kingdoms where they are going to allow the native ruler to rule his subjects, but he has limited sovereignty. For example, the native ruler cannot have diplomatic relations with foreign states, such as France. Okay? And so on. So this is a system of direct and indirect rule. Now, in these native kingdoms, the British would have an officer called the resident. The resident. To ensure that the British could supervise what was happening in that kingdom. Okay? Now, the doctrine, but of course, in the first half of the 1800s, the British are still on an expansionist mode. They are, in fact, absorbing various parts of India within British India. They're going to annex various kingdoms. Okay? And they're going to leave some aside, some alone, and say that there we will post a resident eventually. Okay? Now, some of the kingdoms that are going to be absorbed or annexed, annexation is a word that in fact is actually used, include the kingdom of Awadh. Remember the Nawab of Awadh, who I've discussed several times. Okay? So the British are going to use two justifications for the annexation of these kingdoms. One is the doctrine of paramountcy, and the doctrine of paramountcy states very simply that if the British find that a native ruler is not governing his subjects properly, according to their point of view, they will exercise their rights as the paramount power, as a supreme power, to absorb this kingdom. Okay? The second is called the doctrine of lapse. Doctrine of lapse. And what does the doctrine of lapse stipulate? That if a native ruler does not give birth to a biological heir to the throne, this kingdom will lapse. It will cease to exist. And in other words, it will become absorbed into British India. Now, this was very upsetting to native rulers because according to native customs, Indian customs, if a native ruler did not have a biological heir to the throne, they could adopt a child. And adoption was completely legal under Hindu codes, under Hindu practices. The British did not recognize these adoptions as legal, as legitimate, and this is what the doctrine of lapse stipulates, that in these conditions, when a biological heir to the throne is not produced, okay, the British will in fact absorb this kingdom because it ceases to exist on its own. All right? Now, I've just given you five reasons. We could add another 20 to these if we were going to do an exhaustive study of the rebellion of 1857-58. For example, huge amount of agrarian unrest. Right? As an illustration of another thing, the Caste Disabilities Act, which was passed in 1850, which permitted native converts to Christianity, that is, low-caste Hindus who had converted to Christianity, to inherit property. So this was seen as a violation of Hindu property codes. And what were the customary practices that existed in the Hindu community with respect to the question of property and rights of inheritance? Okay? General Services Enlistment Act, which stipulated that Indians in the East India Company could be called upon to serve anywhere in the company's possessions. For example, in the Middle East, what is called the Middle East here, what we call West Asia and India. Okay? So forth and so on. This is what I mean, that if one were to go down this in serial order, one would come up with a dozen, two dozen, three dozen reasons for why, in fact, the rebellion took place. I've mentioned to you what are five or six of the principal reasons. for this rebellion. Okay. Now, when the rebellion takes place, effectively what happens is the sepoys in Meerut, led by a man called Mangal Pandey. There is a film that has been made, a Hindi blockbuster film. If anybody here is interested, the director, in fact, is a pretty good director because he comes from the Film and Television Institute of India, so he's trained in what is called art cinema, so to speak, right? The film is called Mangal Pandey, if anybody is interested. He is going to march with a bunch of sepoys to Delhi. First, they're going to kill some British. They're going to take over a garrison, okay? Right? And they're going to kill some British soldiers, white soldiers, and then they're going to eventually march to Delhi, and they're going to raise a banner of revolt. When they arrive in Delhi, there's somebody seated there who still represents, in principle, the seat of authority. Never mind the fact that he's somewhat senile, he's actually living on a pension given to him by the British, and has not exercised any real power for several decades, and that is the Mughal emperor. We're still there with the Mughals. He's still there, Bahadur Shah Zafar, right? He's the Mughal emperor. They go to him and they say, will you lead the revolt? Okay? I mean, the man's about 80 years old at this point in time, and he's not keeping in the best of health, right? Again, a very long story. You know, did he consent or not? Was he forced into it? We can't be interested in the details. The long and short of it is, he is going to become the head of the rebels. The rebels are going to be able to take possession of large parts of North India. It's going to be a brutal war. No question about that. Nothing is going to be spared on either side. And the British are going to admit that later on, that there were atrocities that were committed by the British as well. There are certainly atrocities that are committed by the Indians, right? But of course, here the question is, the British are the ones who claim to believe in fair play, right? The idea of justice. There are certain kinds of norms that the British argue they adhere to. And then, of course, the question is, well, what does the suppression of the mutiny show? And when I say the suppression of the mutiny, what does it entail? Let me give you the most dramatic illustration of what it entailed. And there's an article that appeared actually in an American news magazine in 1858, which showed photographs of this. The magazine is called Harper's, okay? It's still published, by the way. All right. And what was this particular form of suppression of the rebellion? You captured a native soldier, you tied him to the cannon, and then you put ammunition in the cannon and you blew. The body would fly into the air, blown into thousands of bits. Okay? Happened routinely. Right? Ferocious suppression of the rebellion of 1857. And in fact, the British claimed that one of the reasons it happened was because the modesty of their women, of English women, had been offended. So after the rebellion is suppressed in 1858, the then Governor General of India, Canning, Lord Canning, okay, instituted an inquiry to see whether there was any credibility to this claim that the reason why the British behaved with such ferociousness was because they were reacting to Indian atrocities, particularly atrocities committed on their own women, on British women. And in fact, Canning's committee came to the conclusion that they could not document a single instance, for example, of the rape of British women. Could not. Right? So one of the things that happens in these things, of course, is rumors float. This is the nature of any war. I mean, if you look at what's happening in Afghanistan today, rumors have a critical place in how people perceive what is happening and how they react to a situation. And the study of rumors is just as important for historians as the study of purported facts. Right? That's what I'm trying to suggest to you. Now, there are, of course, an extraordinary number of complexities. And this is the most calamitous event in 1857-58. Right? Certainly the most sustained resistance to British rule that had occurred up till that point in time. I don't want you to leave with the impression that this was the only form of resistance to British rule. No, this was the most sustained form. There were rebellions that took place in Vellore, for example, in South India, in the early part of the 1800s. And there was enormous agrarian unrest throughout the 1820s, 30s, 40s, 50s. Now, the British are going to suppress the rebellion, which means that they are going to be able to recapture North India. The bulk of the activity takes place in North India. Okay? The Sikhs are going to be important to the British. This is a complicated part of their history. Because to some extent you could say that they helped in the suppression of the rebellion. Okay? So the Punjab is going to become another site of this unrest and dissent. The Punjab and North India, the Gangetic Plains. That's where the unrest is severe. But as I said, the British are going to take repossession of Delhi. There's going to be a siege of Lucknow. If you go to London and you go to the central site that celebrates British military triumphs, and I hope you know what that is, because I'm sure that many of you have been to London, Trafalgar Square. So there's this huge Nelson's column there. Well, on one corner of that, if you look a little attentively, you will find a statue of a man called Havelock. Okay? H-A-V-E-L-O-C-K. Who is Havelock? He is a British general who helped to lift the siege in Lucknow in 1857 because the rebels had taken possession of the residency. And so you've got these couple of hundred Britishers who are holed up in the residency for months trying to defend it from the rebels taking over. This becomes a heroic chapter in British resistance. Okay? Eventually the British are going to recapture Lucknow. Havelock is going to be important, and that's why he's going to be celebrated as one of the great masters of British military strategy. Right? Because when you get put in Trafalgar Square, when a statue of yours gets placed in Trafalgar Square, it means something. Right? Now, when they take repossession, one of the things that's going to happen is they're going to kill outright some of the members of the Mughal emperor's family. His son, for example, is going to be killed. Assassinated, in effect, point blank. Okay? Bahadur Shah Zafar himself is going to be put on trial on charges of treason. And he is going to be banished from India. He's going to die a lonely death in Myanmar, or Burma as it was known then. Okay? That's what's going to happen to him. The Nawab of Awadh is going to be exiled to Calcutta. The most important change from our point of view is this: the East India Company is going to be abolished, finished. John Stuart Mill is going to write the swan song. He's going to write a long memorandum pleading why the company should be retained. And he's going to enumerate, it's called a memorandum on the achievements of the East India Company. He's going to enumerate what were all the achievements of the company, saying the company should not be abolished. But the British take a decision, they're going to abolish the company. Okay? Partly because India is, of course, much too big. It's a huge. It's, as they say, the jewel in the crown. It's the heart of the British Empire. Okay? And what this means, in turn, now, is that India becomes a crown colony. So there's going to be a different way of administering India. There's going to be a man back in London called the Secretary of State for India. He's going to be a member of the British cabinet. And he is going to be responsible for policies formulated in India. Now, remember, by this time, by the late 1850s, the railways, if you remember my lecture last time, I'd mentioned to you the railways, telegraph, all of these come about in the early 1850s, just in the nick of time for the British, because it's going to be very useful for the suppression of the mutiny. Right? If you have the railways, you can rush troops from one part to another where the troops are needed to suppress the rebellion. Okay? And so, of course, after the reorganization of Indian administration, when India becomes a crown colony in the late 1850s, 1858, there is going to be telegraphic communication between the Secretary of State and the Governor General. The Governor General is now going to be called the Viceroy. Okay? The Viceroy. So when he sits in council in India, he's called the Governor General, but otherwise he's representing the British monarch, right? And the British Parliament, and he's called the Viceroy. Okay? And what this means also, the fact that there's this telegraphic exchange, what it means in part is that the Viceroy or the Governor General cannot anymore act with the kind of autonomy that he used to be able to act with before the 1850s. Because now communication is much faster between London and Calcutta. The British capital will continue to be Calcutta. It is only in 1911 that at an official darbar, a darbar is a regal assemblage, okay? And this was, of course, a Mughal practice. The British continue this practice, right? So when you host a darbar, it means that you call all your princes and aristocratic elites, and the British, you know, royalty will be present. Somebody will be present who represents the British royalty. For example, the Prince of Wales, right, who is the first in line, right, in accession to the British throne, as an illustration, right? So there's going to be an assemblage, royal assemblage, a darbar in 1911, where the British are going to announce that they are going to build a new capital. This is, again, goes back to my remarks about the importance of Delhi historically, okay? And this is coming quite late, because by 1911, there's a full-fledged nationalist movement already, right? So it's almost like the British are, there's a kind of a, some implicit recognition that, well, we may have to leave one day. Before we do, let's make sure we leave behind a capital just like the Mughals did, right? It's almost like that, in a way. Of course, it's, again, much more complex, the reasons that led to this shift. But anyhow, let's go back to 1858. As I said, the company is abolished. India becomes a crown colony. The Queen is going to issue a proclamation saying that, well, I realize that this has been a time of great unrest and unease, but I want to assure my Indian subjects, she says, that my Indian subjects will receive the same kind of treatment as my British subjects. Okay? That's the proclamation that she issues. You know, in the 1870s, she will also become, the British monarch will become the Empress of India. You know, that's a different story, but that's again in the 1870s. Right? Now, how do we characterize very briefly in a couple of minutes the 1860s, 1870s, 1880s? Right? Until 1885. Why is 1885 important? Because it's the year when the Indian National Congress is going to be founded, okay? But 1860s to 1880s can be described as a period where the British are trying to now not expand their rule. They're no longer interested in that. They have put into system, into place, the whole apparatus of direct and indirect rule, okay? There are no native powers which are now contesting their sovereignty at this point in time. That's a closed chapter. What they're going to try to do, in the spirit of the Queen's proclamation, you could say, is to try to create an ambiance, right, which is going to be one of harmony. That's the British goal. Let's try to create some degree of cooperation between the Indians and the British. And the best way we can do it is by facilitating, okay, life in India. Trying to improve education, trying to get rid of social customs that are oppressive in our view, backward in our view. For example, restrictions on education of girls, the ability of widows to remarry. In Orthodox Hindu communities of certain kinds, this is a problem. That if a girl gets widowed, she's 16 years old, even younger than that, she's a widow. And in her community, there may be restrictions on her ability to remarry. Right? Now, they're going to take the assistance of Indian social reformers. Right? One thing we cannot really look at here is what happens to Hinduism during this period of time. I mean, I've given you some hints when I've talked about Bankim Chandra Chatterjee many times, the late 19th century Indian nationalist who began to argue that what Indians had to do, what Hindus in particular had to do, was to move away from the spirit of bhakti and devotion and concentrate on the real world. Right? Okay? So what we're saying in the 1860s, expansion of education, the universities of Allahabad, universities of Bombay are going to be founded, for example. Much later on, the University of Delhi, much later on, University of Calcutta will be founded in 1857. Okay? Some attempt to make education more accessible to Indians. Okay? Some attempt to ameliorate social unrest. Some attempt to ameliorate social grievances that Indians might have, certain communities. So this is what I call the era of petition and representation. You go and petition the governor, you petition you know, the district officer, can you help us do such and such thing? What is very clear is that Indians are still completely shut out of administering their own country. For example, let me give you an illustration here. The ICS, this is an acronym, Indian Civil Service, okay? The Indian Service, Civil Service, those who belong to it were colloquially known as the heaven-born, right? Handful of people initially, several hundred by the 1860s, a young Englishman coming from England at the age of 20 or 22 could be appointed the district magistrate of a district with a population of 1 million, had absolutely no knowledge of any Indian languages, for example, could become the collector. This means a collector of revenue. Okay? An Indian could not take the ICS exam in India. So if you're an Indian, you want to join the civil service of your own country, you had to go take the exam, I think you know where, in London. Prohibitively expensive for Indians to do so. Prohibitively expensive. Right? By the 1880s, some people are beginning to say, well, we need to start thinking about what it means to live under the subjection of the British. Right? 1885 is going to be the year when the Indian National Congress is going to be founded. Initially, it is a group comprised entirely of men, of course, at that point in time. The vast majority of them are lawyers, trained in the law, all of them trained in England. Right? You couldn't really do law degrees in India at that point in time. You would have to go to England. Right? And so if you look at the Indian nationalists, the ones that you may have heard something about, or the ones that you're going to read something about for this week, right, who become prominent in the nationalist movement, virtually all of them were credentialed in law. Mohandas Gandhi, Jawaharlal Nehru, Sardar Patel, Muhammad Ali Jinnah, who is going to become the founder of Pakistan, all of them are credentialed in law. Right? These people and others, not Patel, Patel is much younger, Nehru is much younger at this point in time, but I'm saying it's their type who are going to be the people who are going to constitute the initial membership of the Indian National Congress, INC, 1885. The Indian National Congress still exists today, by the way. Okay? It's a party which is now associated with Sonia Gandhi, okay, and her son Rahul Gandhi and Manmohan Singh, you know, okay, the Prime Minister of India. Okay? And of course, it's a shadow of what it used to be, you know, but officially it's the same party, okay, that was founded in 1885. The Indian National Congress Party, by the way, I mean, its history should be written not only with relation to India. It became a model for political parties in much of the third world. The African National Congress, the ANC, was modeled to a great extent on the Indian National Congress, right? So it's a very interesting illustration of where India's the things that take place in India become important in other colonies, right? And this is a point that I cannot elaborate upon here, but one of the things, it's a slightly different point because this was the INC was not a British experiment, obviously, but a related point is the British used India as a laboratory, okay? This is where you conduct experiments, so to speak. How do you control crowds? You conduct these experiments in India. You learn from what's happening in India. Then you apply these methods back home in England itself. Okay? The person who led the Metropolitan Police of London in the early part of the 20th century had spent the greater part of his life in India. Fingerprinting, which becomes very important in police methods throughout the world, is invented in India. Okay? So on and so forth. I could give you a huge list of where these experiments are carried out first in India of policing, social control, and so on. And because India is such an important colony, many of the people who went on to govern Africa on behalf of the British, they first had their training in India. Again, those are long, interesting chapters unto themselves. Okay? But now, let's follow very briefly, very, very briefly, the trajectory of nationalism until the early 20th century. Okay? And the emergence of Mohandas Gandhi. Because you have to keep in mind the emergence of Gandhi. Right? That's critical in many ways. And there are some historians who disagree with that line of approach, thinking that it's not, you know, prudent to isolate one single person. But there is no question in my mind that he is without comparison, without any peer, anywhere. Okay? And so we do have to understand to some degree what is it that his life is going to amount to. But before we can do that, let's just understand the following. Congress founded 1885. What is the method? Petition, again. You go and petition the Governor General. Sir, would you please increase the number of Indians in the administration? Sir, would you consider allowing the ICS exam to be taken by Indians in India? This is what's called petition. By the 1890s, a decade after the Congress is founded, there are going to be people within the Congress who are going to say, this doesn't work. We need to move well beyond petitioning. So there's going to be a rift between the so-called, I'm giving you the conventional analysis at this point in time, you know, since, okay, for obvious reasons. The conventional narrative is there's going to be a rift. The rift is going to lead to two parties within the Congress, two camps. One are called the moderates. The moderates are the ones who believe in petitioning. And then you have what are called the extremists. Sometimes the British are going to call them terrorists, right? The word terrorist has a long history, okay? And how people use it, and how they deploy it for certain political arguments, right? Okay? So what do the extremists believe in? Well, you have to go well beyond petitioning. And this could include the use of violence. So you could say that within the extremists, there are going to be two factions. One is going to believe that the only way to gain some kind of parity for the Indians is to, in fact, start using violence. And of course, eventually, this is going to lead for the demand for independence from colonial rule. Okay? And violence here means assaults on British officials, use of arms, sabotage of railway tracks, and so on and so forth. Now, there was a problem, by the way, there. One problem was the British had passed what was called the Indian Arms Act in the 1860s, which forbid Indians from the ownership of arms, completely. So, you know, orchestrating an armed rebellion was not easy under those circumstances. Okay? But that's one faction of the extremists. The other group of extremists, who are far more interesting, believe that what you need to do is you need to create some kind of mass movement. And why not try to use, for example, religious symbols? The master of this, the political master of this form, is a man called Bal Gangadhar Tilak. Okay? He's going to be put on trial by the British a number of times. He is the closest to being Gandhi's predecessor in some respects. Only in some very limited respects, but important respects. For example, how to mobilize the masses in a political movement. And what is Bal Gangadhar Tilak going to do? Let me give you two illustrations. Okay? One, he is going to take the icon of Shivaji. Tilak himself comes from the same part of the country, Western India. This whole history of Shivaji, projecting him as a first great Indian nationalist, first Indian slash Hindu nationalist, remember Shivaji and the Marathas, right? Resisting the authority of the Mughal emperor. Okay? He is going to take the figure of icon, the icon of Shivaji, I'm sorry, and he's going to raise him, okay? And he's going to try to suggest that in some ways, what we need to do is we need to revive the ideology of Shivaji, okay? This, he becomes a focal point for raising nationalist sentiments. The other thing he's going to do, he's going to take the Ganapati festival. So the Ganapati festival is a festival, right, in honor of the Indian god Ganesh, who's in Hindu mythology the son of Shiva and Parvati. Right? So these Ganapati festivals are huge. Millions of people take part. Now you've already got the millions. Let's see if we can mobilize them in slightly different directions. Right? That's what he's going to attempt to do. He is going to use Hindu mythology and argue against British rule. And he's going to be eminently successful. Because the British are going to see him as a grave threat, which is one reason why he's going to be put on trial on charges of sedition and treason. And be put away for several years. Then he's going to be released. Tilak is a very good example of this lawyer. He's trained in the law. In fact, he's very interesting. And again, an argument I'm simply going to lay before you. You ponder over its consequences and significance. What these lawyers, Gandhi, Tilak, Nehru, do is they show their mastery of the English idiom. They show their mastery of courtroom strategies and saying, we can do better. Okay, if you are going to out-Brahmin the Brahmins, we are going to out-English the English in our understanding of the legal idioms and the space of the courtroom. And very often, I want to say, they want to invite a political trial. It becomes a spectacle. So these political trials of jurisprudence are extraordinary spectacles. And all of these Indian nationalists know how to use these trials to their advantage. Tilak is the one who shows the way, you could say. Okay? If you read the transcript of his trial, the way he parses each word puts the prosecution in difficulties all the time. I mean, they're astounded. They can't understand how this man has this kind of command over the legal language. And of course, he has command over the Shastras, the Hindu Shastras. He's a scholar of Sanskrit. Writes a commentary on the Bhagavad Gita, arguing that the Gita is a work of karma yoga. That is the path that the Gita counsels us to take. Okay, why karma yoga? For the obvious reason, right? That what he's trying to do is suggest we don't need bhakti at this point. We need the yoga of action. Okay? This is what's going to catapult us into a people capable of offering resistance to the British. Now, this is happening in Western India. Mass mobilization. Tilak shows the way. In Eastern India, that's where you have the other great seat of political activity. In Bengal, in Calcutta, which is a seat of the British, obviously. It's the capital at this point in time. Right? And in fact, actually, the Bengalis used to have a saying. I think some of them still persist in that belief, groundless as it may be. But they used to have a saying, what Bengal thinks today, the rest of India thinks tomorrow. Okay? In other words, they thought of themselves as the vanguard. So this goes back to the 1820s, 30s, when you had what was called the Bengal Renaissance. Okay? And remember the abolition of sati, I had pointed out to you that Indians themselves played a role, a critical role in the abolition of sati. So you're going to have these great reform movements in Bengal, 1820s, 30s, 40s, all the way until the end of the century, and you're going to have a militant movement. Eventually, that's going to develop in Bengal. And I'm going to end with just a minute, setting the stage for Gandhi on Wednesday, and that is the Swadeshi movement. Okay, in 1905, in Bengal, the Swadeshi movement, the word Swadeshi here means the following. Swa is a Sanskrit prefix meaning one's own. Desh means country. The Swadeshi movement is a movement. Literally, the word here refers to one's own country. But what it really means is self-reliance. Let us no longer rely upon the British. The Swadeshi movement is going to be a mass movement taking place in 1905, going to pose an enormous challenge to the British. And Gandhi is going to take some of his cues from the Swadeshi movement. Okay? What is the Swadeshi movement going to do? Why does it take place? What does it entail? Well, it entails non-cooperation with the British. For example, boycott of British textiles. So in fact, they would take these British textiles, mill manufactured cloth, put them in a huge heap, and then light fire to it. Renounce British titles. Stop sending your children to British-run schools. This is what non-cooperation means. Why was it promulgated? A, because you needed a mass movement of resistance. The more specific reason was in 1905, the British decided that they were going to partition the province of Bengal. Okay? And they did so because they realized, partly as a consequence of the census, that large parts of East Bengal, so this is Bengal over here, so East Bengal and then West Bengal, that large parts of East Bengal were Muslim, large parts of West Bengal were Hindu. They thought they would create a Hindu-Muslim rift. This is what is called communalism. Okay? But of course, that's not how people thought. Well, yes, I mean, you're Hindu and you're Muslim and you may have distinct identities to some degree, but it's very well understood that Hindus and Muslims take part in each other's festivals. They share lives to a great degree. So in 1905, when the British announced their decision to partition Bengal, they argued that they were doing it for administrative reasons. The province was too big. They wanted to make it much more manageable. At that point in time, okay, the Indian nationalists who become important leaders within the Swadeshi movement are going to resist it. The British are going to arrive at a decision to revoke their earlier decision. It's a great triumph for the nationalist movement. That's what you have to think about. We're going to leave the story there, and I'm going to start with Gandhi in my last lecture on Wednesday.